Welcome to JLife with Daniel. I'm your host, Rabbi Daniel Levine. Okay, well, we are wishing Israel a happy birthday as Israel turns 75 this week after being founded in 1948. And in honor of Israel's 75th birthday, I thought we'd take some time to discuss Israel, the state of Israel, Zionism, and really what Israel means to both me personally and also the Jewish community writ large. There's probably no better and no more important place to start than the idea that Israel is wholly inseparable from Judaism and Jewish identity. And that really applies regardless of what one thinks of the politics of the modern state of Israel. That statement applies whether one views himself on the Israeli right, whether one views himself on the Israeli left, whether one is even against the state of Israel in terms of its existence as a modern political state. It is beyond argument, beyond disagreement, that Israel as a place, Israel as an idea, and Israel as an ideal is inseparable from Judaism. Israel is obviously not just a feature, but a centerfold in Jewish history, in Jewish culture, religion, and philosophy. Israel as a place, Israel as an idea, is where Jews throughout thousands of years in the diaspora have pitted their very hopes and dreams as Jews. It's been Israel, the thought of Israel, the mourning over the destruction of Israel, that according to many historians has kept the Jewish people going as they live through some of the darkest times in Jewish history. It's been the ideal of one day returning to the state of Israel that's been constant inspiration to many poets, many Jewish philosophers, and many Jewish rituals that has been created over the long trek and exciting journey throughout Jewish history. I love Israel. I love the state of Israel, I love the land of Israel, I love the place, the idea of Israel, and that's true even amidst the myriad, and I say myriad, of flaws that Israel, both the place and the state, have in terms of the year 2023. And as a rabbi in the Jewish community, I truly view one of my foundational roles, one of my central parts of my job, is connecting different people and different Jews with Israel. You know, the state of Israel creates an interesting tension when we consider the broad strokes of Jewish history. As we know, just a little historical timeline reminder for our listeners, Judaism obviously began and really proliferated through the state of Israel. If we're giving hard dates, it was King David and King Solomon who lived in about the year 1000 BCE, his son Solomon building the temple in Jerusalem, consecrating Jerusalem to be the center, really the capital of the Jewish world, where the Beit HaMikdash, the centralized temple, sat, where 3+ times a year, all Jews around the state would travel in pilgrimage on the Shalosh Regalim, the holidays of Sukkot, Passover, and Shavuot. And if you think about Israel, over the course of those 1,000 years, Israel wasn't just a part of Jewish culture, Jewish religion, Jewish tradition, but Israel was the definition to some extent of what it meant to be a Jew in the ancient world. And of course, we know what happened. We understand the diaspora that again, first happened in the 6th century BCE by the Babylonians, only to soon end once Cyrus, 70 years later, took over and allowed the Jews back in. But really it was the second diaspora, the subsequent destruction of the temple in the year 70 CE by the Romans, and then the exiling of Jews after the Bar Kokhba revolt in the year 135 BC or CE, that really began the 2,000 years of Jewish exile. And here we get to a fascinating tension, and one of the ways in which I wanted to start this podcast. In the field of psychology, a lot of psychologists have coined what is now known as the problem of arrival. And for anybody who's ever wanted something or yearned for something or wished for something, the problem of arrival is probably something that everybody understands on an intuitive level. The problem of arrival is as follows. Whenever we want something, that can be whether an interpersonal relationship, a new promotion, to win some award, anytime that we set our sights on some goal that we have, that often comes with a whole host of emotional and psychological baggage of when I win that award, when I buy that house, when I do X, Y, and Z, then I'll be happy, then I'll be content. And the problem of arrival is the knowledge and the admission that it isn't actually our achievements that make us happy. And this is something, of course, that psychologists that tackle the problem of happiness write often about. But the idea that if what we have in our mind that it's going to be a physical state that is going to make us happy and content, we're almost always disappointed. And to some extent, viewing Israel through this light is a fascinating, new, and potentially even a provocative way of viewing the state. Now, stay with me here. For thousands of years in exile, the Jewish people have pitted all of their hopes and their dreams, their loftiest ideals, on this place of Israel that was so distant from them, so out of reach, that the myth of Israel began to grow and proliferate in the mind of all Jews and Jewish thinkers throughout the centuries. And then in 1948, it happened, right? We all know the history. We all know Herzl and early Zionism setting into motion a 50 or 60 year process that then, through the lobbying of the British government and then the UN, culminated in the founding of the State of Israel in the year 1948. And with the passing of Israel, we've reached the arrival. And there are actually two different ways one can view this, two different ways that I think gives rise and elucidates one of the central tensions that Israel has today in the Jewish world. On the one hand, we often, and when we say we, I'm certainly including myself in the category, view coming and the founding of the State of Israel as a concluding chapter in Jewish history. If I was writing a book, if I was writing a narrative, if I was personifying the Jewish historical story in a memoir or a biography, Israel would make a perfect fitting chapter. We've gone through the journey. We've wandered through the 2,000 years of desert, to use the metaphor from the Torah's book of Exodus. And all of a sudden, we've returned. We've returned back to the land of Israel. We've had the ingathering of exiles, Jews from all over the world now coming to the State of Israel. And to some extent, if I was writing the finishing touches on this biography or this book, I would love to conclude, and then they lived happily ever after. But of course, we know that history doesn't stop at any imaginary point. History is being created each and every day. And there's no imaginary or mythical finishing point to history. History doesn't work as a neat fictional biographical or memoir book that we get to decide the beginning, middle, and end. History is what we're living right now. And to some extent, even though we can view Zionism and the founding of Israel as sort of a natural finishing point in Jewish history, the obvious point that history is still unfolding screams out to us and tells us the long trek and journey of Jewish history is not finished yet. And who knows in 1,000, 2,000, 3,000, 5,000 years, what future Jews will be talking about, what the next natural beginning, middle, and end point of Jewish history will be. And so to some extent, this creates almost a paradoxical view of Israel, that Israel to some extent represents the greatest arrival that the Jewish people have had in the last 2,000 years. And yet Israel can be equally viewed as a beginning as opposed to an ending, the beginning of a new chapter, a new book, so to speak, of Jewish history, one in which we have new challenges, new problems, new hurdles, and new questions that our community has to come together to answer. Now, we actually can tackle this question from exploring Zionism as an ideology. And one of the questions and one of the points that I always love to get across whenever I'm teaching Zionism to students, whether they be Jewish or non-Jewish or community members in the Jewish community, is that the ideology, the idea of Zionism itself, contains a dialectic. What do I mean by this? That in some ways, Zionism is the most traditional Jewish idea we have in our arsenal of Jewish ideas. The idea of one day returning to Israel, the long track of the diaspora and exile ending in the culmination of the ingathering of exiles, as will be lifted all kanfei nesharim on the wings of eagles, as the prophets tell us, back to Israel, is an idea that Jews throughout the entire world, from Iran and Morocco to Poland and Hungary, have been praying for the last 2,000 years. And so from one point of view, this return, this arrival back to Israel, back to Zionism, whether we're talking about the origins of modern political Zionism in the late 1800s or the founding of Israel in 1948, is as traditional of a Jewish idea as they come. Yet in some other fundamental and important ways, the beginning of Zionism as an ideological movement can equally be viewed as a break from Jewish tradition. What do I mean by that? It was the secular, atheistic, socialistic early Zionists who viewed their idea of creating an autonomous Jewish nation state where Jews would be in control of their own political and military autonomy, who viewed that as a creation of a new Jew, a Jew who would no longer, in the words of the early Zionists, be shackled by some of the archaic nature of Jewish tradition. It was these early Zionists that were inspired not by the deep ideas of Jewish history, but by the new radical ideas of the Jewish Haskalah, the Enlightenment, that came up with the idea of Zionism, not as a part of a commitment to Jewish tradition, but as an attempt to break from Jewish tradition, which many of the early Zionists viewed as too overly static, too overly diasporic, and in the words of many of the early Zionists, too much of people sitting around waiting for God to save us, as opposed to us viewing the saving as being something that could be done by ourselves. And Zionism and the State of Israel contains this dialectic at its core. Zionism in Israel is simultaneously a fundamental part of Judaism, Jewish identity, and Jewish tradition. And in many other ways, Zionism is a fundamental break from the natural mechanisms of Jewish tradition and the deep-rooted traditional Jewish ideas that we fostered over the past 2,000 years. You know, it's funny. The rabbi and philosopher David Hartman gave an analogy, a metaphor, to what Zionists did with the State of Israel. And he writes that Zionism can be akin to, if you imagine a child getting into a huge fight with his parents, and this son is in the kitchen doing all the classic stereotypical teenage boy things that you do when you're mad at your parents. I hate you. I want nothing to do with you. You can fill in the blanks with your vivid imagination. And this child tells their parents, I never want to see you again. I never want to do anything in this house. I'm leaving forever. And the child slams the door and the whole house shakes. But meanwhile, the child hasn't actually left and gone outside, but is sitting there hunkering down in their room, waiting for dinner to be ready. And in some way, David Hartman analogizes Israel to this metaphor, because to some extent, the early Zionists did exactly this. They metaphorically slammed the door in the face of Jewish tradition, saying, we want nothing to do with you, while subsequently and meanwhile, moving to the most Jewish, historic, cultural, and religious place on the planet, and setting up the first Jewish commonwealth and country that we've had in over 2,000 years. Now, the Israel today is quite different than the Zionism of Herzl in the late 1800s, or even the socialistic Mapai labor Ashkenazi Israel of 1948. And Israel has shifted. In a poignant essay that I strongly recommend, Mati Friedman writes a very provocative essay saying that it's not Israel that's necessarily been hijacked. It's just not what the founders imagined. And this is something that I think will be interesting to a lot of listeners, and even to myself, as somebody who considers myself a proud Zionist, but as one clearly in the liberal or left-wing side of Zionism, it gives me food for thought in how I think about Israel. There's oftentimes a narrative in the American Jewish community that Israel has flipped to the right and Israel has been hijacked by illiberal forces. And to some extent, Israel has been going to the right over the past 30 or 40 years. And Israel has been on sort of a pure objective scale sliding towards more illiberalness over the past 30 or 40 years. But to some extent also, this is now the natural continuation of Jewish history. And what I mean by this is over the course of from 1948 and the ingathering of the exiles, it wasn't just the secular Ashkenazi socialistic ideologues that got to determine what the state was going to be. It was truly the entire Jewish world coming together. Today, the Israel of 2023 is much more religious, much less Ashkenazi, and much less secular than the founders envisioned it. And to some extent, Israel truly is an amalgamation of all of the different Jewish ethnic and Jewish religious groups throughout the world. And to some extent, that's what makes Israel such an incredible place, really such a magical place if we think about it in the context of Jewish history. The idea that really for 15, 18, even 2,000 years, the Jewish people have been divided among different geographical lines. We had Ashkenazi, Sephardi, Mizrahi, even within those groups, dozens of subcategories of Jews living in different areas with some communication, but really in broad strokes, disconnected from each other. All of a sudden, the modern state of Israel is a fascinating cultural experiment whereby all of these different and disparate groups of Jews are now stuffed together in one tiny country and left to figure out, how do we govern? How do we set up a country? What should the dialectic and values be between Jewish and democratic, between secular and religious? And this is what makes Israel such a tense issue in the Jewish community, but also such a beautiful issue from the point of view of Jewish tradition. So personally, Israel is always near and dear to my heart. I love Israel, even despite its challenges. And even when I often, in my discussion of Israel, turn to criticism, the criticism is not based in one of hatred, but quite the opposite. Whenever I do speak about Israel in a criticism, in a critical manner, it is only because of my deep love to Israel. The idea that I hold Israel personally to higher standards, not because I want to disparage and bemoan Israel, not because I want to shame Israel, but because I love Israel. Because Israel to me represents the exemplar of my Jewish values. Israel to me represents the culmination of all of the idealism, all of the dreams that Jews have had throughout history. Jews throughout history have had no power. We've had these lofty ideals, but oftentimes no power to implement them. All of a sudden, 75 years ago, that changed. Israel was a first world country with the first rate, the top rate military, backed by other world superpowers. All of the hopes and dreams of Jewish tradition couldn't even imagine a contemporary Israel in the year 2023 and what the state of Jews would be. Our great-great-grandparents, regardless of where they lived, couldn't even dream of the situation for the modern Jew in terms of how good we have it. Let us never forget that. And perhaps to some extent, the idealism of all the hopes and dreams of Jewish tradition is too much to pin on a state. A state, as the Israeli philosopher Yeshayahu Leibowitz constantly was oft to remind us, is full of bureaucracy, full of the banality of the operations of the state. How can we as the Jewish community pin our hopes and aspirations and values on the mechanism of a bureaucratic state? But I've always disagreed. To me, my Zionism truly is one rooted in idealism. We've already checked off, in my opinion, the first step of political Zionism. There's no such thing in the year 2023 as a Jewish refugee. In the year 1945, 1946, 1947, before the state of Israel, the most common adjective that was pinned after Jewish was refugee. About a third to half, depending on the count of Jews in the world, were considered refugees. No country wanted to deal with them. Now, today, there's no such thing as a Jewish refugee. We are, thank God, safe. Of course, there are challenges. Of course, there is terrorism. Of course, there are people that still want the destruction of Israel. But by and large, the Jewish people is safe and in a state that, again, is truly unparalleled throughout Jewish history. We've crossed off the bottom of Maslow's hierarchy of needs. And so next, when I look to the next 75 years of Israel, I'm now focused on the ideals, the values of what Zionism, of what Israel can be. And on this Israeli birthday, as Israel turns 75, I wish Israel a hearty, happy birthday. And I look forward to what the next 75 years of Israel will be. And I'm hoping this is a 75 years where now, once we have all recognized that we've arrived, we no longer fall into the trap of the problem of arrival, thinking we've already crossed the finish lines of Jewish history. And we look forward and really look to Israel and imagine what an Israel can be if it truly becomes a deeper culmination and amalgamation of all of the Jewish ideas, values and ideals that our people have brought with us throughout the last 2,000 years of exile. Happy Yom HaTzmaut. Da 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 da